Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Love, Lies, and Hocus Pocus, Allies, by Lydia Sherrer. Narrated by Amy McFadden. Episode 5. The Economy of Force. Chapter 1. Thicker Than Blood. What kind of music do cats like? Under normal circumstances, this would be a difficult question to answer, one which scientists and cat experts have, no doubt, puzzled over for decades. Lily Singer, on the other hand, didn't have to puzzle. In fact, she didn't even have to ask. She was informed, loudly and unequivocally, that cats prefer jazz, specifically ragtime. This was the obvious answer, she was told, because country was too whiny, rock too angry, pop too undignified, and classical too boring, though it was an acceptable substitute. The expert in question? Sir Edgar Allan Kipling, magical talking cat extraordinaire. What exactly made Sir Kipling an expert on cats' taste in music, Lily had no idea. But she'd learned it was best not to argue with one's cat, at least not if you disliked losing. So it was that she spent the first half hour of their drive shuffling through radio stations until she found one that met Sir Kipling's exacting tastes. How he even knew about jazz, or ragtime, for that matter, was a mystery to her. Up until several weeks ago, he'd been a normal cat, at least as normal as a wizard's cat could be. For Lily Singer was not just the archives manager of Agnes Scott, a private women's college in Atlanta, Georgia. She was also a wizard. And being a wizard meant odd things often happened. In Sir Kipling's case, a mysterious entity had gifted him with human intelligence and the ability to be understood by, but only by, his mistress. That same entity had helped Lily, her mentor Madame Barrington, and her witch friend Sebastian Blackwell stop the theft of a powerful magical artifact, with the side benefit of defeating a greater demon intent on eating them. Yet Sir Kipling hadn't been the only one to come away changed. The entity's otherworldly touch had made her ward bracelet, the wizard equivalent of body armor, more powerful than any magical artifact she'd ever seen. She'd been told the bracelet would protect her, and protect her it had, not just against demons, but against her estranged father, John Faust Le Fay. She'd spent years searching for him, allowing a rift to form between herself and her mother and stepfamily in the process. Yet in the end, it was he who found her. She discovered, too late, why her mother had left him in the first place. A powerful wizard in his own right, her father showed his true face when he attempted to use her in a magical experiment that could have driven her insane, if it had worked. Rescued at the last minute by her friends, Lily was left devastated, wishing she could erase the knowledge of who her father really was, an egomaniacal sociopath. The truth may have freed her, but with that freedom came a burden of responsibility. It was, in fact, the reason for her current road trip with her musically opinionated cat. They were on their way to Bertha, Alabama, to see her family for the first time in 7 years. This reconciliation, or strengthening of the ranks, as her mentor called it, was the first step in preparing Lily and her allies to stop John Faust's insane plan to repopulate the world with wizards so they could benevolently rule mundane society. Completely aside from her father's questionable ethics, the ends justify the means, all is permissible for the greater good, she was quite sure any wizard interference in mundane affairs, or vice versa, would end in disaster and bloodshed. Even if John Faust's desire to preserve the dwindling wizard race was a worthy cause, his methods and ultimate goal were untenable. Of course, stopping John Faust was easier said than done. Besides being exceptionally intelligent, highly skilled, and downright rich, he was also a respected member of the wizard community. Well, respected by some, feared by others. Any attempt to recruit allies against him would be met with scoffing or outright hostility. Lily hadn't known any of this herself, unfortunately, Her mother, Frida, had spent the past 7 years colluding with Madame Barrington to keep Lily as far away from other wizards as possible, all in an attempt to keep her hidden from her father. Their attempt had backfired rather spectacularly, of course, but as angry as it had made Lily, she couldn't blame them for trying to protect her. The dynamics of current wizard society were something her mentor had only recently explained, now that the cat was out of the bag, so to speak. It made their prospects look pretty bleak, though when Lily made a comment to that effect, Madame Barrington had cryptically implied they weren't as friendless as it might seem. But before they did anything else, she first insisted Lily go visit her family. It wasn't that Lily didn't love her stepfather and step-siblings. She was just so different. She didn't fit into their country way of life. They were perfectly content to drive tractors, raise crops, and enjoy the simple but rigorous life of Alabama farmers. Lily, on the other hand, disliked working outside. Knowledge was her milk and honey, and all she'd ever wanted was to read, study, and be left alone. Growing up on a small peanut and cotton farm with four younger siblings to take care of didn't afford much alone time. She'd been happy to leave, and was apprehensive about returning. Even so, she missed her family more deeply than she cared to admit, and was worried how they would react to her visit. What if they wouldn't forgive her long absence? How was she going to explain about wizards and magic? Should she even try? What if they thought she was abnormal? What if they rejected who she'd become? These doubts and more were why she'd never come home. It was easier to keep her distance and bury her loneliness than to deal with the possibility of rejection.
"You know," came a silky meow to her right, "you really should stop worrying. It only makes you cranky."
Sir Kipling twitched his whiskers, not lifting his head from where he lay curled up in the passenger seat. He was quite the picture, his large, fluffy gray body taking up a good part of the seat, while his white-tipped tail hung over the side, slowly flicking back and forth.
"How in the world would you know if I'm worrying?" Lily asked, annoyed.
"You smell different."
"I smell..."
Lily stopped herself and sighed. She should know by now not to try to fathom her cat's maddening ability to know far more than he ought. He claimed it was all part of being a cat, which was hogwash, in her opinion. She was sure the entity who had given him human-like intelligence had given him far more than that. But so far, Sir Kipling was playing dumb. So Lily simply grumbled about his cat magic and left it at that. Silence returned to the car. Lily had turned off the radio to give herself room to think. All right, worry. And she stared blankly at the road. The passing scenery, a mix of coniferous woodland and verdant peanut and cotton fields, offered no comfort. It was only a 3.5-hour drive from Atlanta to Bertha, and they were approaching the end of the journey. As familiar landmarks became more frequent, her apprehension grew, exacerbated by Sir Kipling's exaggerated sniffs and whisker twitches. Of course, such behavior didn't make him appear quite as disapproving as he probably thought it did, owing to the white circle of fur around his eye and the splashes of white on his nose. They made him look like a crotchety old gentleman with a monocle, twitching his mustache. An amusing picture, if Lily could have looked at it instead of at the road ahead. In no time, they were passing Eufaula. The sight of it recalled vivid memories of her and Sebastian's virtuous break-in of the Shorter Mansion Museum during their attempt to undo the Jackson family curse. And, of course, of Sebastian's theatrical escape kiss. It had been suspiciously enthusiastic for being only a ploy to throw off the security guard. At the time, she'd put it down to his generally over-the-top nature. But ever since he'd helped save her from her father's clutches, she'd wondered. Of course, it wasn't the kiss itself that made her blush now as they drove past the quiet Alabama city. It was the memory of how it had made her feel. Feelings she had promptly and appropriately quashed.
"You should have asked him to come with us,"
Sir Kipling commented, once again out of the blue. Lily pushed her glasses further up on the bridge of her nose and kept her eyes fixed on the road.
Sometimes she wondered if her cat could read minds. I have no idea what you're talking about.
Oh, please, don't insult me, Sir Kipling meowed. Your body temperature just shot through the roof, and you're blushing. You're thinking about Sebastian.
It was not a question. That's ridiculous, Lily protested, attempting a casual tone. I could be thinking about any manner of embarrassing things. Self-conscious, but trying to hide it, she reached up to tuck a wayward strand of her chestnut hair behind an ear. Most of it was caught up in the usual bun at the back of her head, but there were some strands that just refused to stay put.
I suppose you could be, Sir Kipling admitted. But you're not, because you also smell—
All right, fine, Lily interrupted, having no desire to know what she smelled like when she was thinking about Sebastian. So I was thinking about him, but only because I'm relieved he's not here. He would just make things worse. Imagine trying to keep him out of trouble and deal with my family at the same time. What a disaster. Sir Kipling murmured, obviously unconvinced.
Of course, his absence also conveniently lets you avoid confronting your feelings.
Lily looked away from the road long enough to glare at her cat. Who elected you matchmaker? I'm dating Richard, for your information.
You mean that lawman who suspects you're lying about everything? At least Sebastian already knows you're a wizard.
Sir Kipling's comment earned him another glare as Lily's insides squirmed. Sebastian is an uncouth reprobate with entirely too many secrets of his own. In any case, he's taken up with that witch, Tina. If you ask me, they deserve each other. Lily knew her words were harsh, but Sir Kipling's barb had stirred an uncharacteristic defensiveness in her.
I see. So, since when does one coffee translate into dating?
He asked, eyes still closed. Well, there would have been more, she pointed out, but things got in the way. Things like being kidnapped by her father, to be precise. She'd only just recovered from that fiasco when Agent Grant got back in touch, hoping to schedule another date. They'd settled on next Friday evening, or at least she thought they had. She'd written it down on a slip of paper by the phone, but hadn't been able to find it the last time she'd looked. She would look again when they got home. That is, if she survived the weekend with her family.
If you say so,
her cat said, dropping the matter, much to Lily's relief. Faced with the dubious task of navigating familial relationships, this was no time to face the complicated tangle of emotions that were her feelings for her troublemaking friend. The sudden ringing of her phone was startling in the heavy silence, and she almost dropped it in her rush to answer.
Hello?
Hi, honey. Her mother's voice sent a comforting warmth through her tense shoulders, and she relaxed. Hello, mother, Lily replied, lips lifting in an unconscious smile. Though her father's schemes had done plenty of harm, they'd had one unexpected benefit, reconciliation with her mother. It had been such a relief to finally make things right. She still felt a tinge of resentment, but she knew her mother had only hidden the truth to protect, not hurt her. How far away are you? Frida asked. After staying with Madame Barrington for a week and visiting Lily every evening, she'd left Atlanta the night before to prepare the house, and the family, for her daughter's visit. Lily checked her map. About 30 minutes or so? Good. Supper's in the oven, and Tom and the others can't wait to see you. At the mention of her stepfather's name, Lily's smile faltered. All right. I'll be there soon. I love you, honey. Bye-bye. I love you, too. Goodbye. The words caught in Lily's throat, but she forced them out anyway. Unlike her mother, who wasn't shy about speaking her mind, Lily had never been good at showing affection. The words felt clunky and alien on her tongue. She was almost embarrassed to let them escape her lips. After recent events, however, she knew it was foolish to take anything for granted. She'd let resentment steal 7 years from her relationship with the people she loved and wasn't planning on giving it any more. If only she could figure out what to do with all these people now that she'd gotten them back.
The dirt road leading to her childhood home was just as bumpy as she remembered. No doubt it had been leveled and repacked at least once since she'd left, yet the typical ridges and washouts had simply reformed. It was like driving over a washboard, and she hoped her aging Honda Civic could handle it. A mix of pine, maple, and oak trees lined one side of the drive, with a ripening field of peanuts on the other. All over, the reddish, sandy soil ubiquitous to the south peeked through sparse undergrowth, and a dust cloud of the stuff rose into the hot August evening, marking their bone-shaking progress. Her teeth rattled as they drove along, a fitting counterpoint to the jitter of butterflies in her stomach. Not even the sight of Sir Kipling's alarmed expression as he gripped the seat with all 18 claws could ease her nervous tension. When they finally rounded the last bend, a two-story farmhouse came into view, its long-ago whitewashed walls now chipped and fading. Yet despite its aged appearance, there were signs of repair, newer boards and paint contrasting sharply with the original construction. There was even a new room built onto one end of the house, probably an additional bedroom. Lily noticed the front porch steps had finally been replaced, much to her mother's relief, she was sure. Broken-down cars and one aged, rusting tractor populated the yard, each surrounded by a ring of weeds and tall grass. Growing up, her stepfather had always talked about repairing them. He probably still did, for that matter. Their working farm equipment was tucked into sheds behind the house, alongside the chicken coop and various other outbuildings her family used in their peanut and cotton farming. As she pulled up to the house, parking beside her mother's dented car and her stepfather's dust-covered pickup truck, the yard erupted with life forms. The first to reach the car were the family dogs, two mutts that barked and leapt in excitement, their claws making scratching sounds against the car door. Lily had only a moment to register Sir Kipling's reaction, back pressed to the seat and ears flattened against his skull, before her attention was pulled toward the crowd pouring out the front door. Her mother led the charge, with her step-siblings close behind and her stepfather bringing up the rear. In typical Southern fashion, they swarmed her as she opened the car door, pulling her out and enveloping her in one hug after another, all exclaiming and talking over one another. Of her siblings, there was Drew, the oldest and tallest, a more youthful version of his tanned and weathered father. Then came Sally, blonde hair bleached almost white by the sun that she loved to work in. Third was Becca, only a year younger than Sally, but as different from her as night was from day, with dark brown hair and a fiery temperament to match her sister's easygoing one. Last was little Jamie, or at least he'd been little when she'd left 7 years ago. Now he was a lanky, chestnut-haired young man of 15. Of her four siblings, he was her only half-sibling, the others being step-siblings, offspring from her stepfather's first marriage. Surrounded by chaos, smiles, and voices, it felt for a moment like she'd never left. Despite their differences, her stepfamily was still her family, the only one she'd ever known. Amid the rush of loud and crushing goodwill, she belatedly recalled the defining mark of their relationship— their good-natured disregard of her personal space. Ah, well, one couldn't expect too much as an introvert in a family full of extroverts, and Southerners to boot. Yet as they surrounded her, pelting her with one question after another, she could tell by their sideways glances that all was not as idyllic as it seemed on the surface. That was when she finally noticed Jamie had not joined the throng. Before she'd left for college, he'd been as rambunctious as any 8-year-old boy, always in the thick of things. But now he hung back, solemn face unreadable, as he stared at her with gray-blue eyes. There was something odd about him, a sort of presence she couldn't recall being there when he was a boy. She'd practically raised him, with Frida busy helping her stepfather on the farm. But he'd grown so much since then. He looked and felt like a completely different person. Frida finally took control of the chaos, shooting off orders like a general deploying her troops and breaking Lily's concentration.
She sent Drew to the car for Lily's bags, Sally to round up the dogs. They were sniffing excitedly at Lily's open car door, undeterred by the furious hissing coming from within, and the others inside to set the table for supper. Lily watched Jamie as he retreated, trying to figure out what was so different. But her mother distracted her as she began to pull her toward the house and the waiting food. At a plaintive meow from inside the car, Lily came back to herself, regaining her head for the first time since the swirl of chaos had descended. "Really, Mother, it's all right. I remember how to get to the kitchen. I'll be along in a moment," she said, extracting herself from her mother's hold and turning back to the car. With the offending canines now safely tied to the front porch railing, Sir Kipling had ventured down from his perch on the passenger seat headrest, where he'd taken refuge from their frenzied yapping. He looked distinctly ruffled. Though the fur along his back now lay flat, his fluffy tail still resembled a bottle brush. If cats could frown, he would have.
"While your confidence in my capacity for self-preservation is refreshing, I would prefer, in the future, to be forewarned of threats upon my life," he said in his most disapproving tone.
"I do apologize. It slipped my mind." Lily tried only half-heartedly to hide her grin. She was sorry. It had slipped her mind, and she wasn't one to laugh at another's misfortune. That was Sebastian's purview. Yet only a complete stick in the mud would pass up a chance to chuckle at the expense of her annoyingly smug cat. Sir Kipling shot her an irritated look.
"If you expect me to put up with these mongrels for 2 whole days, you had better be prepared to pay the price."
"The price?" Lily asked with a raised eyebrow, the urge to smile still threatening to betray her.
"Salmon, every day, for a week," Sir Kipling said decisively.
"I see. Well, that depends on whether or not you behave yourself." He sniffed.
"Behaving is for dogs."
"Behaving is for troublemakers, like you. Now, are you going to walk to the house, or shall I carry you?"
"I have my dignity," he said, jumping down to the dusty ground and glaring in the direction of the 2 dogs,
both of whom sat at quivering attention, eyes following his every move. "You know, you could just stay in the house. They're outside dogs."
"And let them think they have the upper hand. Inconceivable. These are dogs we're talking about. Besides, I'll need to inspect things, get the lay of the land."
"If you say so," Lily said, giving up the fight with her facial muscles and letting a grin spread across her face. "I'll leave you to it, then." Closing her car door, she headed for the house, feeling in better spirits. At least she wasn't the only one with problems. Supper time at the Singer house was just as she remembered, loud, chaotic, and delicious. Her mother hadn't been much of a cook before she remarried. Lily remembered living off grits, fried cabbage, and cold chicken for most of her early childhood. But once Frida had 4 new mouths to feed, all used to the delights of traditional Southern cooking, she'd finally bitten the bullet. With help from enough cookbooks to choke a herd of horses, she'd done what she always did when she put her mind to something. Succeeded. Frida could now cook with the best of them and had taught Lily to do the same. Admittedly, Lily's cooking had become much more cosmopolitan since moving to Atlanta. Unlike her mother, she preferred not to smother everything in grease and butter. Thus, she was slightly overwhelmed by the abrupt return to all things Southern, with a dinner of pork chops, fried chicken, fried okra, collard greens, mashed potatoes, and corn pudding, topped off with a chess pie so sweet you could feel your insides crystallizing as you ate it. During the meal, she fielded question after question about her job, house, love interests, which she deftly sidestepped, and life in Atlanta. It was similar yet different in important ways from Ursula's busybody grilling a mere 2 weeks ago. Her grandmother had only cared about what advantage Lily brought to the LaFay name. The Singer clan, on the other hand, wanted to share in her life, so she made an effort to remain open.
Of course, there was the teensy matter of her being a fully-fledged wizard that she had to keep tiptoeing around, glancing toward her mother the whole time. Despite some initial awkwardness, she felt herself warming to these familiar strangers, so grown and changed over the years. Their eager joy in every detail she divulged made it clear that they had truly missed her. She'd left her siblings a group of obnoxious adolescents who'd since blossomed into young adulthood. Drew was as loud and country as you might expect, but well-rounded, with a healthy dose of manners no doubt pounded into him by his father, with whom he worked on a daily basis. Sally was the mature one, obviously having taken Lily's place as their mother's primary helper. Her good-natured words were employed liberally to keep peace in this family of hard heads and quick tongues, the quickest being Becca's. She'd broken from the family tradition of farming and was attending the local community college. While Becca had certainly grown out of her snotty brat stage, her new personality as a sarcastic teenager wasn't much better. Lily decided she and Sir Kipling would get along very well if only they could understand each other. But the most changed was Jamie. The fun-loving boy she remembered was gone. Oh, he joked readily enough with his other siblings, but he barely said a word to her and didn't ask a single question. Perhaps it was because he'd been so young when she left. He wasn't used to her now. She hoped the explanation was that simple. Of all her family, she'd been looking forward to seeing Jamie the most. He'd been her little pal, her jammy boy. While the others had been off raising hell around the farm, she and Jamie used to curl up in a cool corner together while she read to him. Even as he grew into the energetic 8-year-old she remembered, he'd always preferred hanging around Lily and asking incessant questions to climbing on tractors or hunting down frogs in the creek. But now he shied away from her gaze and only murmured responses to the few questions she was able to work in amid the storm of conversation. And that strange feeling kept bothering her. She couldn't put her finger on it, but it reminded her of something. Once supper was over, she tried to help with the dishes, but was rebuffed by Sally.
"You go rest your feet now, here,"
Sally said, busily gathering up dishes and silverware to take to the kitchen. While Frida had instilled in Lily the importance of proper English, she hadn't managed the same with Lily's step-siblings. They took after their father, southern twang rolling off their tongues like honey. So while Sally did the dishes and Tom and Drew headed outside to finish up the evening chores, Frida showed Lily to her room. Her room wasn't technically a bedroom. It was the attic. Being a family of seven in an old farmhouse, they'd had to make do. Growing up, her siblings had shared two of the three bedrooms, her parents occupying the third. Above one end of the house, the eaves peaked to make a small attic that got dreadfully hot in the summer, but was vastly preferable to sharing a room with her overloud siblings. Now, at least, her parents had moved to the new bedroom downstairs, which meant Drew and Jamie each had their own rooms, with Sally and Becca sharing the third. But the little attic room had been left untouched. As her mother opened the door, she could see all her things were just as she'd left them, though they'd been joined by several piles of boxes. It was an attic, after all.
"I dusted things up and washed the sheets," her mother said. "I thought you'd prefer your old room, though if the heat's too much, you're welcome to change your mind. I could make Jamie sleep with Drew, and you could have Jamie's room, or the couch downstairs."
"No, this is fine," Lily assured her, staunchly ignoring the beads of sweat already forming on her forehead. It was worth it for some privacy. Looking around, she saw Drew had already laid her bags on the bed, though Sir Kipling was nowhere in sight. She briefly wondered if she should go looking for him. She hadn't heard a peep out of the dogs, so she had no clue what he was up to, but decided against it. If he was going to accompany her in what was quickly becoming a bona fide adventure, she couldn't constantly worry about him. Either he could take care of himself, or he couldn't. So far, he'd handled demons, crazy wizards, a mechanical crow, and more besides, with signature grace, so she doubted a couple of excitable dogs would pose much trouble.
"Well, I'll leave you to unpack," Frida said after a moment of awkward silence.
Lily stopped her with an outstretched hand and a look.
Not so hasty, Mother dear.
She closed the attic door and pulled her mother to the bed, taking a seat beside her.
You aren't going anywhere until you explain to me why you haven't told them yet.
Told them what?
Her mother asked, avoiding her gaze.
About us, that's what,
Lily said, thoroughly exasperated. I understand why you kept it from me all those years, to protect me. But now John Faust knows who I am and can easily figure out where I'm from, if he hasn't already. We need to tell them, for their own safety. What if John Faust shows up one day looking for you, or me? They need to know, and we need to ward the house.
Frida opened her mouth to protest, but Lily raised a hand. I know any magic in a backwater place like this will shine out like a beacon, but he can find us easily enough without it, so there's no point hiding anymore.
You didn't really stop using magic because you feared it, did you? That's what he said happened.
No, of course not.
Frida's sigh was deep and long.
I only stopped to keep us hidden. Since then, I've grown positively rusty. But I doubt you'll accept that excuse.
She smiled faintly at her daughter, who smiled back.
Not a chance, Mother. I saw you flinging enough magic at that man to know you remember your Enkinim well enough. Madam B gave me a full rundown of wards to use on the house, and one way or another, you're going to help me cast them.
Yes, Frida said with another sigh. She warned me she would do that. She agrees with you, of course. Better to tell the truth. I just don't know how to tell them. After so many years, they won't believe us.
Of course they won't, but we have to tell them all the same. And you will be the one to do it, not me. You're the one who decided to keep it a secret in the first place, and you're better at explaining things anyway.
I suppose. Perhaps in the morning.
No, now, Lily insisted. No more waiting. No more lies.
Well, about that.
What?
Lily asked suspiciously. I didn't know for sure, not until yesterday when I got home after using magic for the first time in years. My senses weren't what they used to be. I felt it as I approached the house. And as soon as I saw him, I knew.
Frida trailed off, worry creasing her brow.
Lily's skin tingled in sudden realization, and her eyes widened as she stared in disbelief at her mother.
No.
Yes, Frida insisted with a resigned nod.
Your little brother is a wizard.
They agreed it was best not to reveal that particular bombshell just yet, as Frida gathered the various family members around the dining room table. Their expressions ranged from curious to confused. The exception was Jamie. His eyes were alight with a keen interest, and she caught him staring at her again, though he looked away when their eyes met. Once everyone was settled, Frida looked around at each of them, then glanced to the side at Lily. Lily could see her own apprehension mirrored in her mother's eyes. Without a word, she reached under the table and took hold of her mother's hand, grasping it firmly. Frida squeezed gratefully, then took a deep breath and began.
As I'm sure you guessed after I rushed off unexpectedly to Atlanta, some interesting things have happened recently. While we're all thrilled to have Lily back with us, I realize the time has come to tell you all some things I've kept secret for a very long time, though your father knows parts of it.
Frida exchanged a look with her husband, who smiled back encouragingly. Lily felt a sudden and unexpected wash of love for her stepfather. He was just a simple farmer, more concerned with the weather than with philosophical discussions or current events. He had no grand words or great intellect, just a solid work ethic and a kind heart. Lily had never truly understood him, but she could see that he loved her mother and his family with a selfless depth that a man like John Faust would never comprehend.
You all know that I left my first husband, a man named John Faust Le Fay, when Lily was very young, then later met and married Tom. What you don't know is that I left because John abused us.
There was a sharp intake of breath from Becca, and Drew's eyes flashed in outrage. But Frida ignored them and went on.
I feared for our lives, so I acquired false identities and hid us for several years, never staying in one place for long. I knew John would never stop looking, so even though I met your father years after, I decided we had to keep living under our assumed identities. I never breathed a word about it to anyone but Tom, and then only after we were married. He wanted to track down my former husband and have him arrested, but I convinced him to let the matter go.
She smiled faintly in reminiscence, but Lily could only shiver, imagining what John Faust would have done to her stepfather had the man shown up on his doorstep.
Not only would it have been impossible to prove the abuse, as we never reported it at the time, but there was the small matter of living under a false identity for almost a decade. I knew that if John ever found Lily before she came of age, he would be legally entitled to full custody, and I would likely go to jail.
Lily's step-siblings looked at each other, brows creasing in confusion, but Tom simply looked weary.
I did technically kidnap you, Frida said in way of explanation, looking at Lily apologetically, who simply shrugged. Once she turned 18, she was safe, at least legally, from John, Frida continued. But I still never told her the truth. I thought it was for the best, to keep her safe. But, of course, the truth never stays hidden forever. 2 weeks ago, John somehow found Lily and made contact with her. Having no idea the kind of man he was, because I'd never warned her, Lily went to him, and he abused her, much as he had when she was a child. I went with some old friends to get her out, and we spent the past week getting reacquainted. Now the truth is out. John knows Lily's assumed identity and can easily find out mine, as well as where we live. I have no notion what he will do about it, but there's a possibility he might come here looking for, I don't know, revenge, reconciliation, legal redress. According to the state of Georgia, I'm still married to him under my old name, and I don't know what will come of it. She let out a long sigh and bent her head forward, resting it in her hands as she massaged her temples. Everyone around the table made sympathetic noises, and Sally began to rise as if to come over and comfort her mother. But Frida stopped them all with a raised hand. That isn't all.
The table fell silent again. Lily glanced at Jamie, whose sharp eyes were locked onto Frida's face.
Unfortunately, this isn't just a simple matter of spousal abuse and legal complications. Because, you see, John Faust is a very powerful... Well, he's a...
Frida halted, at a loss for words, and looked desperately at Lily. Lily grimaced, knowing what she had to do, even as she cringed inside. Desperately trying to organize her thoughts, she imagined she was giving a lecture on magic to a young child. If she fixed her eyes on the cross stitch of their farmhouse hanging on the wall behind Sally's head, maybe she could get through this. I know this will be hard to believe, but what Mother is trying to say is, well, certain people can do... Oh, dear. Lily took a deep breath. She just had to say it. Some people are born with the ability to manipulate a form of energy that is most commonly known as magic. There was a complete silence around the table, and from her peripheral vision, she could see growing disbelief on everyone's face. All except Jamie's. He was leaning forward in his chair, gaze intent. Lily swallowed, mouth dry as sandpaper. While it may seem far-fetched, the best way to understand it is that magic is a form of science that modern technology hasn't yet developed enough to explain. After all, 1,000 years ago, primitive people would have considered planes, cell phones, and computers to be magic. But today, they are commonplace tools that operate within the laws of nature. The point is, some people are able to sense and use this energy to do some rather magical-seeming things. These people are called wizards. She faltered for a moment, heart pounding, but then forged onward. I am a wizard. So is Mother. I've spent the last 7 years learning how to use magic. John Faust is also a wizard. A very, very powerful one. He's not afraid to use magic to get what he wants. That's why, I assume, Mother never went to the police. In any case, he used it on us a long time ago and did so again last week. Lily's vision was starting to blur. She was staring at the cross stitch so hard. Frida took their joined hands from where they rested on her lap and laid them on the table, putting her other hand on top of Lily's. He plans to do some bad things, and I have to figure out a way to stop him. I don't know what will happen, but he might come here and try to hurt you all. So Mother and I are going to put protective wards on you and the house. I can imagine how confusing this must be. I couldn't believe it either when I first found out. But you will have to trust us. Our lives may depend on it. She finished, feeling very hot and prickly. She couldn't bring herself to look at anyone, so she kept her gaze on the opposite wall. Tom was the first to speak.
Well, I can't rightly say I understand this hocus-pocus stuff you're talking about, but in this here family, we look out for one another. You and your mama do what you gotta do. Any fella thinks they can mess with us has got another think coming.
Lily was finally able to tear her gaze from the wall and dare a glance at her stepfather. He gave her an encouraging nod and reached across the table to rest his large, calloused hands on top of hers and Frida's. Drew and Sally both reached forward to join him, murmuring words of solidarity. Becca, however, leaned back in her chair, incredulity written all over her face. Lily looked to her left, expecting to see excitement on Jamie's face. She was surprised to see his brow furrowed in hurt and disappointment as he looked back and forth between her and Frida. Finally, he fixed his gaze on his mother.
"Prove it,"
he said sharply. Though she'd been expecting a demand for a demonstration, Lily's mind still scrambled to think of an appropriate spell. Most spells, contrary to how they were portrayed in mundane pop culture, were not flashy. Though she could see magic, so to speak, in her mind's eye, it wasn't visible to mundanes. Much like electricity, gravity, or magnetism, the only visible aspect of magic was the effect it had on the world around them. She glanced at Frida, who had the same deer-in-the-headlights look she imagined was on her own face. Casting around desperately, she finally spotted a sheet of aluminum foil left over from supper preparation. That would work. Aluminum was the easiest metal to manipulate, as it was the most conductive to magic. She retrieved it, laying it on the table, and sitting back down to calm her mind, forcing herself to breathe evenly as she considered the words of power she would need to complete the spell. When she was ready, she started speaking that ancient tongue, using words and will to shape the magic as it compressed the foil, looking for all the world as if an invisible fist were crushing it into a ball. Everyone but Frida jumped in shock. Becca actually jerked back so hard she capsized, her chair making a raucous clatter as it made contact with the worn wooden floor. She quickly picked herself back up, swearing in colorful southern fashion. Ignoring her stepsister, Lily focused on her spell. The foil crackled as it shrank, and Lily felt the tingle of energy coursing through her as she concentrated on the trickiest part. Instead of simply crushing it into a rough ball, she spoke again, upping the pressure and adding heat as she crafted her tennis ball-sized lump of crumpled foil into a marble-sized ball of solid aluminum. The air grew cool around them. The heat had to come from somewhere. And finally, it was finished. As she ended the spell and cut the flow of magic, the aluminum marble dropped to the table with a clink and rolled toward the edge, toward Jamie. To Lily's surprise, he scrambled back, eyes wide with disbelief. She couldn't understand why he seemed so startled when, before, he'd been hanging on their every word, as if he already knew what was coming.
Whatever the reason, he shot her a bewildered look, then took off out the front door.
Frida called after him and made to follow, but Tom put a hand on her arm.
Let him go, Mary.
Frida smiled weakly at him.
Well, Frida Le Fay, legally, but I guess we'll stick with Mary Singer for now.
You'll always be my Mary,
he said, standing to wrap her in his arms.
This is just freaky. I can't do this. You're all freaks,
Becca declared shakily and headed upstairs. Drew and Sally exchanged looks. While they appeared as shocked as everyone else, they seemed to be taking the news a bit more calmly. With a nod from their father, Sally rose and headed after Becca, while Drew got up and started for the front door.
No, I'll go,
Lily said, rising abruptly. She didn't know why, but somehow she knew she had to talk to Jamie, alone. Drew shrugged and stepped aside as Lily headed out the door, scooping up the still warm aluminum marble as she went. She knew exactly where Jamie had gone. The farmyard barn was a piece of history, as old as the farmhouse itself. Its boards were weathered gray with age, and the tin roof was brown with rust. Back when her stepfather was a mere boy, and his father and grandfather ran the farm, they'd had a few head of cattle, goats, and some horses. Thus, the hayloft had been full of old-fashioned square bales, hay for fodder and straw for bedding. Nowadays, the barn was used more for equipment storage, but some of the bales remained, slowly disintegrating as they sat, unused. Well, unused for farming. It was the perfect play place for enterprising children, and her step-siblings had spent many an hour building straw forts and otherwise getting covered in the stuff. She'd preferred to watch from afar. Straw dust was a nightmare to get out of your hair. But in the cool of the evenings, when the barn was empty and quiet, she loved to climb up and sit in the open hay door, where long ago they'd loaded bales into the loft. With feet dangling over empty air, she would read her books and watch the sun sink behind the green hills. Once he was old enough to climb the wooden ladder to the loft, Jamie had often joined her, and it had become their special place. 7 years later, she climbed the loft ladder once again, hands automatically finding its worn rungs in the semi-dark of the old barn. It smelled just as she remembered, musty and dry, with a hint of motor oil. As her head crested the lip of the loft floor, she could see Jamie's hunched shape in the open hay door, silhouetted by the setting sun. Moving quietly, she completed her climb and headed toward him, loose straw shifting softly beneath her feet. Jamie didn't turn as she approached, and she hesitated behind him, building up the nerve to sit down.
You know, it was never the same after you left.
Jamie's voice was low, and he didn't turn to face her. Lily sighed and finally sat, leaving a few inches of space between herself and her half-brother. Not sure what to say, she remained silent, staring at the crimson sky.
The others picked on me more without you there to tell them off, especially Becca. I never really fit in. It wouldn't have been so bad if you'd just come back once in a while. But you never called, never visited. You didn't even return my letters. It was like you didn't love me anymore.
He still didn't look at her, but his words were filled with a bitterness that sent stabs of guilt straight to her heart. She wanted to protest, explain that she hadn't realized the envelopes addressed in her mother's handwriting had contained letters from him. She'd taken one look at the handwriting and thrown them in the trash, unopened.
It hurt for a while. I kept asking Mom why he didn't come back, but she would never give me a straight answer. Finally, I stopped trying. I thought maybe I'd done something wrong, been a bad brother. But finally I realized you were just a selfish jerk who didn't care enough about her family to give a darn what they felt.
He finally turned toward her, eyes burning. She opened her mouth to defend herself,
then shut it again, looking away. He was right. Not that she would have admitted that several years ago, or even a few months ago. But now, in light of recent events, her shortcomings crowded in, burning with the same accusation that was in Jamie's eyes. Closing her own eyes, as if to shut out the accusing stares, she steeled herself to do what she should have done years ago.
"You're right. I was a selfish jerk,"
Lily finally croaked, forcing the words out of reluctant lips. Daring a glance to the side, she saw a flicker of surprise on Jamie's face. That brief softening of expression gave her the courage to continue.
"I was an absolute butthead to you and the others, and I'm sorry. But please don't think it was because I didn't care. I was just so angry and hurt and stubborn, and a little afraid, too."
The words started spilling out, and she let them.
"I thought about you all the time in the beginning, but I tried to suppress my feelings and stay as far away as possible to take revenge on Mother."
Lily looked down, feeling a flush of shame as she realized how petty her words sounded. But she had to explain.
"You know how Mother would never talk about the past, about who my father was? Well, it hurt more than I realized, and after I left, I just wanted her to know what it felt like to be kept in the dark. I'm sorry. I was too focused on my own feelings to consider how my actions must have affected the rest of the family. And then, when I found out I was a wizard, I thought if I came back, Mother would yell at me for finding out what she'd been hiding all this time. I thought it would just be easier for everyone if I stayed away."
She glanced up and saw her brother's eyes flash with the same intense curiosity he'd shown at the dinner table. But he quickly hid it and returned to scowling, obviously not done being mad at her.
"Easier for you, maybe,"
he growled.
"Did it ever cross your mind that I might want to know, too? I am the only one in this family besides Mom who's actually related to you."
"No," Lily replied honestly. "I never imagined you would..."
She trailed off, distracted by the sudden realization that she could see his magic. The aura was subtle, which was why she hadn't been able to pin it down before. But now that she knew what to look for, she kept catching glimpses of it. It wasn't the blaze of her father, nor the soft glow of her mother, nor the cloaked majesty of her mentor. It was faint and ethereal, like the shimmer of heat in summer that shivered in the currents of hot air rising from the ground. She wondered how her own magic appeared to him, or if he could even sense it, untrained as he was. Though he still scowled stubbornly, his expression began to soften around the edges as she finally met his gaze, staring as intently at him as he had at her not hours before.
"When did you..."
she began hesitantly.
"About a year ago. At least that's when I started noticing it as more than just a vague, undefinable feeling.
Like an itch in your soul?"
he finished for her.
"Yeah, like you know you can do more, but you have no idea what it is."
"And the blur?"
Lily asked, fascinated.
"Like you have something in your eye, but only when you look at certain things."
Jamie nodded.
"Did you ever guess?"
Lily was curious. She'd had no idea, just a feeling of difference, a restlessness that had driven her to seek answers. Jamie considered for a moment, scowl lines now replaced with a thoughtful scrunch of the brow.
"Not really. Not magic. But I knew something was up, what with the way you left and Mom acting like a clam. But now you're back, and it's all out. You can teach me. Show me. I want to know everything."
The excited light was back now, and he leaned toward her, eagerness written in every line of his body. Lily hesitated, unsure.
"I don't know if I'm the one who should explain things. I've never taught magic, and I've only been studying it for 7 years. In any case, I'm leaving tomorrow, as soon as we're done with the wards. I'm sure Mother will show you."
"What?"
Jamie exclaimed, looking hurt.
"Leaving?
You can't leave. You just got back.
I'm sorry. She shrugged helplessly. I have a job, not to mention a psychotic father to deal with.
He leaned forward, eager once more.
Then let me come with you. You can teach me on the way. I can help.
No, absolutely not, Lily said. You're too young. And you don't learn magic on the way. It takes years of study to even do your first spell. Plus, it's dangerous. Magic can kill you if you don't do it right, and the further you stay away from John Faust, the better.
That's not fair, Jamie protested. I want to help. I want to go with you. Anyway, you can't just waltz in here, tell me I'm a wizard, then leave.
She hadn't done anything of the sort, but decided it wouldn't help to point that out.
Look, I know it doesn't seem like it, but Mother is just as good a wizard as I am and can teach you everything you need to know.
That wasn't quite true, but the things Frida couldn't teach him were years ahead in his magical education anyway.
I'll make sure she promises to teach you before I leave. The only reason she kept everything a secret before was to protect our family from John Faust, but there's no need for that anymore. She'll open up now.
But I just got you back,
Jamie whispered, a desperate look in his eyes. It was suddenly as if the past 7 years had never happened, and he was 8 again, begging her not to leave. Something squeezed her heart, and she felt moisture gather in the corners of her eyes. Scooting closer, she wrapped her little brother in a tentative hug, unsure at first, but gripping more tightly as he leaned in and hugged her back.
I'm sorry, she murmured into his hair. I promise I'll come back this time. And I'll give you my phone number. You can call any time you want.
He snorted, now pushing back against the hug.
Hey, it's not like I need to talk or anything mushy like that. I just want to learn magic. What do you think I am, sensitive?
He stuck out his tongue at her, a teasing twinkle in his eye.
Ah, yes. Now I remember, she drawled back. You're a teenager. Heaven forbid you have a meaningful relationship with your sister. You'd lose all your hard-earned street cred for sure. Something like that.
Jamie grinned and stood up.
You coming?
In a little while, Lily said. I want to enjoy the sunset and the memories.
Jamie nodded, but as he turned to go, Lily stopped him with a gesture. Getting up, she took his hand and dropped the aluminum ball into it, closing his fingers around it. Don't fool yourself with silly fantasies. Magic is glorious and terrifying in equal measures. It's dangerous and difficult to control and can do just as much damage as good. Which one it does is up to you. Be careful, little brother. Eyes shining in the near darkness, he nodded.
I will,
he said. Then turned and climbed down the ladder to the dirt-covered floor below. Chapter 2. The Supreme Art of War. It was fully dark before Lily finally groped her way down the loft ladder and headed back to the house. Once outside the barn, she could see a little better. The stars were bright above, and patches of light spilled out from the farmhouse windows. She was just crossing the barnyard, contemplating the evening's events, when a dark streak shot out from some bushes and charged straight at her. A cry of surprise was halfway to her lips before she realized the streak was Sir Kipling, the white tip of his fluffy tail bobbing with every stride. He skidded to a halt by her feet, back arched and fur standing on end, as he gazed toward the house, ignoring her presence.
Sir Edgar Allan Kipling? You are an absolute terror! Don't scare me like that!
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.